Hi, good morning, everyone. Welcome to our live session today. My name is John from Asia Pacific University of Technology and Innovation, APU. While waiting for more people to join our live session, I would like to let you know that there are three live seminar talks today. These seminar talks cover AI in healthcare, post-master opportunity in data science, and analytic-driven MBA. For your information, today is also our postgrad open day. So you are welcome to visit us in the campus from 10 a.m. to 4 p.m. For those who are unable to visit us physically, you may make an appointment with us for a virtual online counseling session. For more information, please visit our website at www.apu.edu.my and follow our Facebook page. Today, we are proud to have Dr. Selva presenting to you on AI in healthcare. So welcome, Dr. Selva. Hi, Dr. Selva.
Hello, good morning.
Yeah, good morning. Yes. So you may start for the section.
Yeah, thank you.
So is everyone joining already? Are you excited for the section? Is everyone have your breakfast? It's good if you have already had your breakfast, huh? Yes, is anyone of you know about healthcare, but in AI? Okay, are you guys ready? Dr. Selva going to start the section. Okay, Dr. Selva, you can start.
Good morning. Welcome to our first session titled Artificial Intelligence in the Healthcare. This is Dr. M. Selva Kumar Samuel. I'm working as a senior lecturer in APU under the School of Technology. I hope you enjoyed the video. This is a right example of how artificial intelligence affects music as well, or entertainment industry as well. It is an honor to be here with you all today. You are an important people, a light people, because only the very best people in general or in any field will take the time and make the sacrifice to come for a talk like this. Thanks to all listeners who were joined. You are going to enjoy the time we spent together this morning. I'm going to share with you the role, the applications of artificial intelligence in the healthcare sector, especially on how artificial intelligence based technologies or AI enabled technologies help healthcare services. So that is our main focus for today. Let's move on to the session. What is AI or artificial intelligence? AI is the science of it's a part of computer science or part of a subset of computer science of trying to, or that tries to reflect human intelligence into a machine. The machine can be a computer, can be a robot, or any computable or maybe computational technologies, any healthcare technologies. AI has an unimaginable potential within the next couple of years. If we redesigned healthcare completely with the help of AI, we will be able to mine, extract, and utilize vast amounts of medical data that will be able to support making better diagnosis and treatment plans for the doctors. Even it can better understand the information that can be collected or gleaned from our DNA. AI-enabled or AI-based healthcare can help with the range of traditional approaches that can be applied to all medical solutions to target the treatments, personal therapies, and uniquely customized medications. However, this will take years to go. This will take many years to go to fully enjoy the benefit of AI in healthcare. But almost 10 to 20% of the benefits of AI we applied in the healthcare sector as of now. Artificial intelligence, as I just mentioned, is a part of computer science that tries to replicate human way of doing the things or human intelligence on machines. So one of the important ability of human or our natural intelligence, our human intelligence, is learning. We learn from others. We learn through observations. We learn from maybe reading, through reading. So that, for example, I'm sharing. Whatever I learn. Same way, the machine nowadays is able to learn. The technique, the presentation techniques, what I'm using is one of the techniques to train, to share some information to others. But how we can train a machine? What is the method? So artificial intelligence has many methods. One of the popular method or one of the method widely used by the industry is machine learning. Let's see this video. That is machine learning. So the machine learning from the human. The method, the technique we use to train the machine is called as machine learning. Maybe it is machine training method means would be very appropriate, but mostly we understand or we use the word machine learning. The learning capability, the learning ability of a machine really very useful, or that capability really making many applications, particularly in healthcare sector as well. Even we are going to see many technologies, many applications. Everywhere the key, the core is learning. AI can be applied in any industry or every industry, being applied in every industry. But today we are going to focus on healthcare. Healthcare means we cannot leave as of now without COVID-19 or without discussing about COVID-19. So I'm going to share some information related to COVID-19, how the AI helped COVID-19 or helped the doctors to diagnose or screen COVID-19. Recently, I had written a book chapter on COVID-19, particularly the title is The Role of AI for COVID-19 Screening. So that is the title of the book chapter. So I'm going to share share some information with you. Consider AI-based advances or applications is one of the promising answers for well-being screening tool. People screening or disease screening. During this challenging situation or during this pandemic period, AI-based technologies or solutions have been applied greatly to screen the COVID-19. This approach amazingly accelerates screening procedures and expanded screening accuracy. AI-powered or AI-enabled systems or applications or tools were able to screen and detect COVID-19 within a few seconds. That is the major applications. This is perhaps the fastest among the standard disease screening procedures available as of now. AI has been helping to screen and detect COVID-19 quickly using various approaches such as voice samples, CT scan images, cough sounds, and other predictive patterns. Due to the application of AI-based methods and technologies, healthcare centers able to screen many thousand people in a short period of time. I believe that is the major benefit of AI. AI algorithms such as machine learning, deep learning are the two major promising solutions that have been applied by the researchers to provide solutions to fight with the COVID-19 conclusively. Just mentioned CT scan, X-ray, these are the common alternate methods. Without AI, nowadays it's not possible to evaluate or to study a CT scan. The reason is the large population, largely populated countries, they have limited doctors. To evaluate a CT scan, a doctor usually take 10 to 15 minutes. But AI-based, AI-enabled, AI-powered technologies able to screen in seconds. So that's the major advantage. That's why many of the countries able to screen thousands and thousands of people. There are many things we can discuss, but due to the time constraint, let me share some information related to the diagnosis methods. The common or usual medical test, nothing but diagnostic test and antibody test, are the two medical tests that can be used to screen COVID-19. Due to some medical factors, antibody test is not actively used to diagnose COVID-19. I'm not from medical side. What I learned when I was writing the book, I'm sharing now. Currently, the diagnostic test, also called as molecular test, maybe particularly if you ask the name RT-PCR test, and antigen test are the commonly used tests to diagnose, to screen COVID-19. Currently, the RT-PCR based methods are mostly used by medical physicians to diagnose COVID-19, but It is a time-consuming method. To overcome the current critical situations, current demand of screening, rapid methods are required, actually, particularly to substitute or to complement the molecular test. There are many recent AI-based, artificial intelligence-based, or powered studies or technologies are available, methods are available, provided by many researchers or many scientists. They are really promising solutions for screening COVID-19 cases, particularly using CT scans, chest X-rays. These are the major applications or alternate applications to molecular test. Deep learning or machine learning. Maybe later I will point out, maybe I will explain a little bit about what is deep learning. Efficiently, these machine learning techniques or AI methods are efficiently used to diagnose COVID-19 cases. AI powered, one more test, actually very popular test, recently they introduced anosmia is a medical term, nothing but loss of smell is one of the important symptoms of COVID-19, because sometimes they are okay, no fever or nothing, but they are not able to smell, they are not able to taste. Loss of taste is called as agusia. Maybe I'm wrongly pronouncing, means please excuse me. Anyway, loss of smell test and loss of taste test, these are the two new tests doctors are using to screen or to diagnose COVID-19 as well. This is one of the important contribution of AI. AI is helping. Even one more recent test in UK, Saudi Arabia, and even in India, they developed a new test called, they use the voice samples, cough sounds, to screen the COVID-19. These two methods actually is possible because of the application of AI. So with that, I end this discussion, the application of AI in COVID-19. Let's move on to the other important technologies. Extended reality is one of the new term, because recently, because of Industry 4.0 and Industrial Revolutions 4.0, many new terms have been introduced, like big data, data analytics. So one of the new term in the area of virtual reality is nothing but extended reality. Virtual reality, of course, is one of the common technology being used to train the peoples, basically. Augmented reality, then mixed reality, now extended reality. Extended reality, I can say, as per my concern, my opinion is an alternate term to the mixed reality. Let's see some applications about this. The extended reality, also called as immersive technology, is another new term. Basically, virtual reality means experiencing things through our computers that don't really exist, or computer-generated virtual environment. That is virtual reality. Through VR devices or virtual reality devices, we will be able to interact with the virtual environment. That is virtual reality. Augmented reality, basically it produces digital contents, or mix the digital contents with the virtual reality content, or maybe real environment. So that is augmented reality. Maybe you all can easily find from your mobile phones or smartphones, augmented reality. Mixed reality, basically the mixed effect of both virtual reality and augmented reality, basically. So extended reality is the alternate term it's alternate term for mixed reality. The video is Let me play the video again. The application of extended reality or mixed reality really very remarkable in the field of in the healthcare sectors, healthcare services. Just imagine a surgeon preparing for a complicated brain surgery. The hospital received scan images, and a mixed reality device renders it into a three-dimensional holographic image. That image, we call it as holographic image. What you see here is a holographic image. The doctor can take a look at the problematic area, analyze it layer by layer, like what you see here, and plan their entire intervention. They could literally zoom in, zoom out of the patient before making any decisions or the first incision. Imagine medical students study autonomy in groups while dissecting the holographic body without physical limitations. So that is another important application of immersive technology or extended reality in the medical field, to train the medical students. But what I like most is this. It can be a companion for the elderly people. The technology can take them to their school days. So it is one of the way to treat our psychological treatment nowadays. Those who are depressed, those who are facing some anxiety related issues, this, or maybe elderly people, they are having different issues. So this is one of the way to treat psychologically, to boost their mind and body. Okay, next important area where the AI is being applied, nothing but genetics, or we can call it as clinical genetics. Genome sequencing is one of the process. Full genome sequencing is basically a method of deciphering your entire DNA and looking at through the lenses of our collective knowledge of how our genome affects our health. It can be a gold mine of informations. It can show your risk for certain diseases, meaning is early detection of diseases that would otherwise not know of. And so you can create a preventive plan around it with your physician to shape your lifestyle in a way to keep your health in the long run. So early detection is one of the important applications of genetics. With the help of AI, this is possible as of now. For example, if your genome report shows that you have risk of diabetes, you can change your diet and exercise more to try to prevent it from happening in the future. It will be hard to imagine that there was a time when our diet, our lifestyle were arbitrary and not based on science, basically. Many tests are already available that we are still waiting for the comprehensive test. But there are many tests are available to understand this. The impact of genomics on every aspect of healthcare, from medications, sensitivity to nutrition, will be a huge impact. Medication as well as in the nutrition side. AI really making a remarkable role in this field as well, in these technologies as well. Next, other very common, or one of the buzzwords as of now, data analytics. if there is no AI methods like machine learning or deep learning, means you cannot see the popularity of data analytics or big data analytics as of, I mean, what we see, I mean, the popularity is because of the AI methods or AI applications on data science. One of the important application or one of the important outcome of the AI and data analytics is precision medicine. According to the Precision Medicine Initiative, precision medicine is an emerging approach for disease treatment and prevention that takes into account individual variability in genes, environment, and lifestyle for each person. This approach actually allows doctors and researchers to predict more accurately which treatment and prevention strategies for a particular disease. It is in contrast to a one size fits all approach. That is one of the common approach. You may notice that, I mean, that is the common medical practices. If you approach any doctor, they will diagnose with the usual test. Based on the outcome of the test, they will predict, okay, this could be the, this is the disease, and they plan for the treatment. But based on this precision medicine, we can get the, or maybe the patients can get the more precise treatment. Doctors able to plan more precisely. Precision is the major outcome of this marriage between AI and data analysis. So this will consider various aspects, as I just mentioned, lifestyle, our diet, our personal health related data, medical history, even our family medical history. All the data will be collected using data analytical methods. Data will be analyzed. But based on the analysis outcome, the doctor will be able to take very precise plan for the treatment. Next important combination is AI and Internet of Things, in short, IoT. Connecting computers, we are calling as, or connected computers, we are calling as computer network. Connected mobile devices or smartphones, we are calling as mobile network. But mobile network connecting only mobile devices or smartphones. Computer network only connecting computers. But what is IoT? Connecting every physical objects, connectable objects. Car, washing machine, your healthcare devices, healthcare equipments, or your, even some of the home appliances, anything, any physical objects, whatever is, have the provision to connect, able to connect. So network of things, network of multiple or heterogeneous type of things, physical things, that is called as IoT. One of the important application of IoT is automated data gathering or automatic data gathering. That ability, that capability of IoT really helping healthcare sector. You all know the, various IoT sensors or sensors are available being used in healthcare sector to extract various health related data. Those days doctor have to measure the temperature, or maybe they have to wait for some maybe pressure result or temperature result or some other reports. But now everything automatically measured by IoT sensors, the data will transfer to the doctor's device. Then doctor will be able to help or able to plan for the treatment very quickly, able to monitor very quickly, able to monitor easily. So that is one of the important application of AI with IoT. Researchers made many best technologies, and what you see here, I'm just going to explain some of the points here, like healthcare sensors, telemedicine, portable diagnostic devices, and wearables. Smartwatch, what you see is a smartwatch from Apple. This will be able to scan even the, it's like a cardio device. It can scan like an ECG machine. And one more important device, what you see on the left side of the screen, digital tattoos. On the right side, you can see brain-computer interface. Actually, it's very useful for the disabled people, those who are not able to move. Maybe brain is working good, but other parts of the body, organs not working, not functioning means brain-computer interface is one of the important application of IoT with AI. So they can provide instructions, or the interface, or the sensors able to sense the brain instructions and transfer to the robotic parts, which is attached to the human body, or maybe they want to control other robots, maybe just to help there, to provide some services to the disabled people. Particularly the digital tattoo with the rise of portable diagnostic devices is actually one of the portable device. The device is really able, that's the meaning of portable. Wearables you can wear as well. If you don't want, you can remove. So like this, more or less all are same type of devices, but it has different approaches, a different ways we can use. That's the point here. So really the current healthcare benefited from IoT and AI remarkably. You cannot see any medical devices, equipments now without the role of IoT and without the role of AI. One of the important point here, the telemedicine, healthcare sensors, and I think it's one of the important application during this COVID-19 challenging situation. Healthcare sensors and telemedicine will change all of that and make patients the point of care. They don't need to travel. Something like that. Even today, wearables are the mainstream, and particularly the Apple Watch or the devices, cardio devices, any cardio devices have such great health functions that have reportedly saved multiple lives by alerting users in time of a serious cardiovascular conditions. But in the future, we will measure not just heart rate and step count, but pretty much everything we can, from blood pressure, it's possible now, to respiration patterns, ECG, and so on. We can talk more about this. Okay, let's move on to the next technology being used in healthcare together with AI. Nothing but surgical robots. It's very important application, particularly for very critical operations as of now. What you see the video is a sample of surgical robots applications. The doctor can practice and find the absolute way to operate on the patient and let the robot support their procedures. Then when reaching absolute precision and no shaking hands, some surgical robots could follow pre-programmed protocols, pre-programmed functionalities, and become semi or even fully autonomous in performing surgery nowadays. This is how robotics can become a perfect tool in the hands of physicians or the surgeons. But robots can also disrupt healthcare in many other ways as well. Machines, for example, machines do not need sleep or food, don't have prejudices, that is very important. For example, disinfecting the hospital rooms, disinfecting the hospital room in minutes actually can deliver the medicine to the 10th floor, for example. What I see as a major outcome, major benefit with the marriage of robots and AI, particularly surgical robots and AI, precision, controlled, efficiency. These are the three major benefits: efficiency in the operation, controlled operation, precision, very precise. Actually, it's very safe. That is another important concern. Sorry, another important benefit actually. Thousands of surgical robots working in hospitals today, but there is still a long road ahead, long way to go to the healthcare to be benefited with AI and surgical robots. Next, AI with 3D printing. You may hear about 4D printing nowadays already available, but in the healthcare side, 3D printing. In healthcare, 3D bioprinting. That is already available, but not for the, I mean, it in the initial level actually. What you see here is the first bio-printed heart is breathing here. First bio-printed heart. 3D printers have been all over, I mean, have been in the news for the past few years. From printing weapons to printing entire buildings, but they are most impactful. Feature is yet to receive the spotlight actually. Probably the first thing that comes to mind in terms of health care is that 3D printing can be the solution for people in need of mobility devices such as prosthetics. But in healthcare is bioprinting. It is the creation of living tissues such as blood vessels, bones, or organs through 3D printing. Are any organs through 3D printing able to print? This can be an answer to the world organs shortage. But printing organs is a bit more complicated than printing prosthetics. But one day, we might be able to successfully restore a function of damaged organs. What you see in this picture is actually, or in this video, is the first bioprinted heart. But here there is no blood vessels, chambers, all. But recently, this another bioprinted heart, but with blood vessels, ventricles, and chambers. So more advanced compared to the previous. This was this in 2019. This was printed actually. So this will be a real or alternate solution for the organ shortage. Maybe just maybe further down the line, if one of your organs needs to be replaced and you are sending a tissue sample, living tissue sample, to a nearby printing facility, 3D bio printing facility, a few days later they could send you back a new functioning organ, maybe through a courier service. As of now, it is science fiction, but this will become fact in near future. Next, nanotechnology. It's another buzzword. Nanoparticles, microparticles, nano robots. Nano, how to measure, I mean, if you compare the size of a nano, is actually 1 billionth of a meter. 1 billionth of a meter. It's like the fingertip, actually 85,000. And is a part of here, 85,000 multiple parts actually. So it's very, very small, as 1 to 10 nanometer size basically. So that particles, that technology can be applied in healthcare sector fruitfully with the help of AI. Nanotechnology, I mean, microparticles have already been shown to swim in the eye and perform procedures, already working on that. But what if nanoparticles and nano devices could operate as precise drug delivery systems? That means deliver the drug directly to the affected organs. Just imagine a nanometer sized tool injector into your body that release medication but does not get attacked by our immune system. How about injecting chemotherapy into cancer cells while keeping healthy cells untouched? Microscopic robots inside you, in case is already injected or already implanted, could send warnings to your smartphone that that the disease is about to develop in your body, so you can try to prevent it. It all seems like science fiction, but is amazing actually, but still pure science fiction. In case if it become real, it can change the entire medical treatments, healthcare sectors. Very precise solutions. Like it can predict, or you can link a nanoparticle to the cancer cells, sorry, to the immune system, maybe work together, plan together to kill the cancer cells, can destroy the cancer cells, or without touching the healthy cells, it can destroy the cancer cells. Likewise, we can go for many type of solutions. Unimaginable solutions are actually available, the marriage of AI and nanotechnology. Okay, actually we can discuss more about that. Those who are listening, or those who are going to be a potential student of ours, you will learn more about this. And those who are listening, come to our campus, explore our programs. We are educating the students, not training the students. For example, if you educate a person with a car, he will know how to make a car. If you train a person with a car, he will be a driver. So we don't make drivers, we make engineers to build a car, to build an aircraft. So likewise, any field, any technology field, we educate. So that is the important requirement as of now. He will not be the user of a tool. If you train somebody with a tool, they will be a user of your tool, but we don't train. We educate how to make the tool. What are the concepts, principles behind? So that is our main or important method we use here. So come and explore. Okay, in conclusion, technology really plays an important role on society today. It has positive and negative impacts on the world. AI-enabled technologies, AI-powered technologies, especially affect our lives positively. Positively only, I never see any negative impact of AI in healthcare sector or healthcare services. Thank you. If you have any questions, you can raise. The moderator can convey. Thank you so much.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Selva, for your sharing. So now is our Q&A section. So everyone, please feel free to drop your question at our comments area. So now we have received some question. Okay, this question is from Ms. Chen Man Kok. It's like, what is other than healthcare, what are the other significant applications of AI that we can see in Malaysia?
Other than healthcare,
what are the other significant applications of AI that we can see in Malaysia?
Okay, it's a good question. But the healthcare is one of the essential service. That's why I choose. Of course, AI can help any business. Business intelligence is one of the important example of that. Business intelligence solutions, data analytics. So data analytics and business intelligence helping business to boost the sales. So any Malaysian businesses or industries can adopt. Importantly, Industry 4.0 is a standard which was given for manufacturing sector or production sector. The standard is based on AI, IoT, data analytics. So nowadays, if you claim your organization, your production company, or your production process is Industry 4.0 standard, means you are already using AI, you already benefited from AI. But industrial revolutions, the founder, maybe you know, is the founder of World Economic Forum as well. He listed more than 100 over industries where industrial revolution technologies can be applied. So there is no limitation on that, any industry. For example, one of the industrial revolution-based technology for business sector like banking business or financial sector, fintech, is the answer to the our industrial revolution 4.0 answer for the business sector, finance sector, fintech. Actually, there is a role of AI in fintech as well, or in the business solutions or finance solutions as well. Any government services can use the artificial intelligence. As I mentioned earlier, the main application of AI in healthcare or in any technology, whatever technology I discussed just now, like nanotechnology, IoT, or robotics, whatever it is, basically what is happening there, learning from the humans, and it perform with increased precision, with high efficiency, fast. So that is the major application. So the learning is the key. So for example, if you take a normal, maybe any education system, basically what we are doing, whatever the industry, whatever the domain, computing domain, IT domain, or any engineering domain, business management studies, basically what is happening there, they are preparing students for particular industry. So what is happening there? Training, learning, education, educating the people. They are learning actually from the from their lecturers. So likewise, any industry can learn with the help of AI, and it can perform their task efficiently, precisely, more effectively, better than even some extents better than human. Okay, maybe one more point I would like to add here. One of the book author, Unstrom, he wrote a book called titled Super Intelligence. Based on the ability of the AI, he classified the AI into three major AI, major types. Natural intelligence, artificial natural intelligence, artificial general intelligence, artificial super intelligence. So what we are benefited now, I mean, mostly the applications what we have is based on natural intelligence, ANI, which is basically learn from the humans and just repeat. A robot will learn from a human and you'll repeat the repeated task. So that is happening now. But what is next? More or less similar to human. Third one, super intelligence, better than human. So that in case in future super intelligence is possible means almost all industry will be benefited to improve the efficiency. That's all.
Okay. So thank you, Dr. Selva.
Yes.
Yeah, we have another question from Faha Othman.
Okay.
So let's see the question. So how can AI apply to prevention and curing of infection disease like COVID-19, HIV, HSV? Has it been applied or yet to be?
Yeah, it is already applied. Earlier I mentioned about some of the screening methods. For example, if you want to, a doctor want to diagnose a very serious cancer, at least maybe with all the technologies in hand, without AI, I'm telling, without AI, all the technologies in hand, medical technologies in hand, they will be able to predict, screen, maybe 24 hours time. Okay, so sometimes 24 hours is really a long duration for a person who is seriously infected or maybe in the very dangerous situation or maybe very advanced level of infections. But with the help of AI, they will be able to screen even in seconds. Like a COVID-19, as you asked, cough testing and cough sound, actually. So you can collect the cough sound of a patient. You no need to go to no need to go and see any doctor for screening. You need to send your cough sound samples to the, even you no need to send to anybody. There are applications available nowadays. The cough sound, you have to record the cough sound, then you have to enable the application. The application will screen or analyze the cough sound, and it will tell you whether you are infected with COVID-19 or not. So that is the application of AI. So mainly what I see, even as I repeated few times, screening, that is the major application, whatever the disease, HIV or whatever very serious viruses, screening is important actually. So how it is, maybe the other words, other things what I explained, precision, that is very important, accurate detection. Second one, efficient. Third one, as I mentioned, fast, very quickly able to detect. Yes. So not necessarily few hours of time, few days of time to find, to predict, to screen, to diagnose a disease. That is another thing. Second important application of AI, help to plan for the treatment, precise plan. Okay, so earlier I discussed about genetics, application of genetics and AI. It can precisely tell you what disease may be in future, maybe after 4 years of time exactly, you will get this disease. So because the already the groundwork is going on, the virus is all trying to make that problem. The bad bacteria are trying to make that problem. So such a prediction is possible, early detection. So maybe in other words. So these all are common where AI can help better than human, okay, some extent. Not necessarily this particular, because for example, as a computer science person, for me, any programming languages is same actually. For me, any software application is a software, that's all. Same, right? For AI, just the application only is this disease or this particular virus, there is no such thing actually. For AI, AI means is what? Human, what we have is a natural intelligence. If any machine shows any intelligence, that is nothing but artificial intelligence. Mm-hmm. So what machine is doing, what a human can train to the machine, same thing it is going to repeat. Mm-hmm. That's all. So that a human can predict HIV virus means, or it can screen HIV virus means, a robot also able to predict, because, but only thing, artificial intelligence. That's all.
Mm. Okay. Thank you, Dr. Selva. Okay, there's another question from the audience. Let's share it. Okay, it's from the third ABBA. The question is, how AI can be used in classroom, especially for formative assessment?
Actually, that's why I separated. Education is different, training is different. The tools available as of now is a training tool. Actually, it's a long, I don't think. Actually, for some purpose or some functionalities can be done. Okay, for example, taking attendance in the classroom means it can help, because it's just a no need to apply our intelligence to take attendance. So that kind of work all the robots can do.
Is it applied in
actually APU? I don't think, yeah.
Is this function applied in APU? Like taking attendance?
Of course, this is a very, very basic application. So we have the algorithms, we have the applications actually. Even our scheduling system, timetabling also is based on AI application, and attendance system is also, it's more or less is AI application, is automated solution. So what is automated is also is AI application. that's why I said, if any machine, any application shows intelligence, smart, nothing but AI is there. Okay, your phone earlier, our original, maybe the originally we call it as PDA, after some time mobile phone, but now what we call smartphone. If you see the word smart, the application of AI is there, artificial intelligence is there. Actually I understand, but you know, there are universities, they are using robots to teach. Robot cannot teach, robot cannot educate, robot can train, that's all. So that that's the thing I'm telling, but it is not necessary. Everything, if you depend on artificial intelligence, that's not fair. But certain applications where human cannot perform effectively, efficiently, but machine can take the task and it can perform effectively, efficiently than human, then you can apply. What human can still do better than a machine, let the human do. So teaching or education should not be done by, or should not be trained or taught by a machine. That is not fair. So second thing, what you mentioned, assessment. No, it is your task, because you are learning something, so you have to do. So don't depend on the assessment. But I can say, for example, search engines. It is helping you to search the right informations easily compared to those days of search engine. Now the search engine is based on AI applications, semantic search engines. So it's intelligent search engines. So it is like a Google, Yahoo, these all are helping you. So that extent, surely it is helping for assessments. I hope you I answered.
Yep. Okay. So thank you, Dr. Selva, and thank you everyone for joining this live section. Okay, so we are going to have the next session about the postmaster opportunity in data science at 2 p.m. later. So stay tuned and do remember to follow our Facebook page for more updates. Other than that, APU is having open day 2 days from 10 a.m. to 4 p.m. Please feel free to drop by to meet our academic team and counselor. Okay, so bye everyone, and see you guys in the next session. Thank you, Dr. Selva Kumar.
Thank you.
Bye.